the Taliban and the prospect of negotiating with the Taliban. We're trying to get them to be, to cooperate at least with the idea of long-term peace. This sounds like it will encourage the Taliban to be more active, to step up their campaign.
I think the issue of Taliban is different from this tribe. Yeah, really, the long-term the strategy for the peace to come to Afghanistan, it is other strategy. Still, this is the local arrangement with the tribe elders in the area, and I don't think the Taliban should respect to this arrangement in the area, because this will be not resolving the problem. And the Taliban always, they are trying to prolong the problem and to spread that to the other area, because in one area to be pacific by the Taliban, it will be damage for them, and they should not be patient in one area to be bombed or to be killed or to be the, right. The nitrate. I don't think, I think the American, they need to do something for long-term solution to resolve the problem in Afghanistan.
Okay.
And I think that with the local people, they have no problem. That's not mean the tribe leader, when they are signing something with them, it is fighting with the nation.
Right.
I think this is not completely fighting with the nation. It is,
I want to bring in Matthew Ho here again and say, Matt, one of the key things Ambassador Zaif is saying, and listening to what Major General Richard Mills said, the contrast is that this doesn't look like it could be a long-term and secure situation, and that really this leaves the idea of the success is, again, maybe at a transient one. How do you regard it when the U.S. Says, we're having success in the region, we're achieving our goals in Afghanistan then?
We've heard this for a number of years. We keep hearing anecdotes. The reality is, you look at the trends, you look at the data, you look at the metrics, the situation of Afghanistan has gotten worse every year since 2005, when NATO decided to expand outside of Kabul and expand the presence of the central government. Major General Mills referenced the schools in Helmand. Well, just last week, the governor of Helmand said only 80%, or actually, I'm sorry, 80% of schools are closed in Helmand because security is so bad. He referenced the success in Marja. Well, 2nd Battalion, 9th Marines is one of the units stationed there. They've had several Marines killed the past few weeks and many wounded. So you continually hear these things on a whole level, on a national level. Attacks in Afghanistan are up twice the level they were up last year at this time, which was twice the level they were up the year previously. So this idea that we're achieving success is just not being borne out by any facts, by any data, by any trends, by the reality.
And what Ambassador Zaif was referring to there was the idea that perhaps this these kind of pacts in, like in Sangin, could not be repeated throughout the country for a long-term national level of peace.
What you have to do when you do these pacts is you have to make sure you can get the short-term success, you can get that short-term ceasefire, and you can get that drop in casualties maybe for just that one particular area, so for that one village, as Ambassador Zaif was saying. However, what do you do to sustain that? How do you keep this going a year from now, 3 years from now, 5 years from now? And so that's the concern. Is this built into the Afghan government? Are these tribal elders, are these local elders, these village elders, how are they going to be linked into the governing process? How are they going to be linked into the district council? How are they going to have a say into what the Afghan government does in their villages and in their valleys and in their areas? And similarly, the security forces. We know that only about 3 to 5% of the Afghan army is composed of Southern Pashtuns. What are we doing to bring Southern Pashtuns into the security forces and keep them in the security forces so that 5 years, 10 years from now, security forces in those areas are composed of people from those areas?
So, I mean, ultimately, it's been an up and down situation in Afghanistan. When you look at where things are going, I know you've been critical for what's been going on. Is it taking the right direction then?
Well, talking is the best step. But I also go back to what I've been saying now for 18 months or however long. And people have been saying this well before I said it as well too, that the foreign presence is driving insurgency, is pushing people to support the insurgency, that the best thing we can do in many cases is pull foreign troops out of valleys and villages where the locals are fighting them and supporting the Taliban for no reason other than they're being occupied.
Right.
So I still say that that's the best solution. And from an American perspective as well, a lot of these fights are these intertribal, intervillage, interfamilial fights that have nothing to do with American or Western national security interests.
Right.
But
right.
Now we find American or Western troops caught in the middle of a conflict that predates their arrival there, and that they can't possibly begin to understand or unravel, and it doesn't concern them. So again, my thing is, start pulling American forces, Western forces out of there. Not completely, but just to, you know,
take
enough
the fuel from the fire.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So it should die down. Let me ask you though, with your travels around the U.S., how much tolerance is there among the American public now for a continued campaign?
When I speak to congressional leaders or I speak to other leaders in the country about what is the best thing they can do to get the U.S. to withdraw from Afghanistan or begin the process or change the political climate so that the president feels that he can choose an alternative to what the Pentagon is suggesting, I say fix the economy. We find that over 60%, and actually it skyrockets when people learn that the United States will spend $119 billion in FY 2011 in Afghanistan. The opposition to the war is great, near its two-thirds, and again, with cost factored in, it skyrockets over that. But the problem is that people are distracted by the economy. Everyone's got a few homes in foreclosure on their street. Their cousin hasn't been able to get a job in a year. It's very different than 2006, when the economy was doing well, when your house was worth twice what you paid for it, you know, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So if we can somehow change the dynamic to get people to act upon their preference for us not being Afghanistan, I think that will give the president that political space he needs to do something different in Afghanistan and not follow the requests of the Pentagon and others who are pro-war policy.
And Ambassador Zaif, to get your perspective on that, the way Afghanistan can move forward in governing itself, how ready do you think the people of Afghanistan are ready to look after the country without it falling apart and going into civil war or being overrun by the Taliban?
Yeah, really there is a lot of distance to combine something or to bring the people to the government to decrease this distance. I think the problem is not between government and the people. It's not problem between the government and the Taliban or the tribe leader. Problem is, I think, the activities of America and the prison of them and their operation in Afghanistan. This is the real problem. They should not, Americans should not condemn the people of Afghanistan for something, why the people they are not joining with the government, why they are not, the Pashtun, they are not participating in the military or the national police or national army. I think they are, until the American, they are continuing their activities in Afghanistan, in operation in Afghanistan, it's not bringing the people by force to join with the government. It's increasing, I think, the distance and increasing the hateness between the people and the government. It's increasing the distance between Taliban and the government. I think this is the real problem. It's not the problem the tribe leader. I think that they should think about this problem, how to resolve the problem. I think this is will be the main question. It's not some kind of thing that they should blame someone or the Pashtun they are not with the government, how they should bring. I think by this kind of activities, the Pashtuns especially, they are absent from the area. The army, which is the army of Afghanistan, they are called nationally. By my opinion, it's not national army. It's not national police, right? Because the majority of the country, they are absent and they are not feeling that's country and that government is my government. I know that Mr. Mangal or other always they are talking about the progress, about the successful, but really this is not.
Okay.
When I'm looking to the area in the situation, I know that it's a big difference between the situation and they're talking and I think that they said we have a progress, but always for since 10 years when we are looking hearing there are progress, there will be resolved the problem, and next year it's better.
Okay.
But we are looking the situation became worse day by day. I think it is necessary to be fundamental strategy for the to resolve the problem.
Okay, well, Ambassador Abdulsalam Zaif, I thank you very much, sir, for joining us again on the show. Matthew Ho, thanks again to you for your contribution as well, and of course Major General Richard Mills, who joined us at the top. Thank you for being with us. Remember, you can catch a podcast of the show on iTunes. This week we're featuring my conversation with comedian, actor and star of The Daily Show, Asif Manvi. On the next show, a new Cold War over currency, Well, China's President Hu Jintao is coming to Washington, where struggles over monetary policy is just one of the many topics he faces. We'll examine the key issues in Sino-American relations and look at their global impact. Be sure to tune in for that. From me and the team, we'll see you next time.